Please join me in prayer. Holy One, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts collectively be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. In today's scripture, we are urged to ask the animals and to speak to the earth. I love the Message translation, put your ear to the ground. In this poetic language of the book of Job, we hear that the life of every creature and the breath of humankind itself rests in God's hands. This connection between all of creation and God the Creator is one that means that we are all a part of this grand artistry of our Creator God, and that we are all, in fact, containing divinity within us. This is a profound truth that lies at the very core of Celtic spirituality and of the Christian faith and of other spiritual practices. And as an Irish-American, these words from the book of Job this morning cause me to recall the words on St. Patrick's breastplate, which reads, "Christ with us, and Christ in every eye that sees me, and Christ in every ear that hears me." We seek to see the God in nature, and we delight in the knowledge that we are made in God's own image. God, who holds each of us in God's hand, who made each of us, also dwells within each of us. So, if we truly believe that there is this spark of God, of divinity in creation and in each of us, how then do we behave towards creation, towards one another? How do we treat the earth, the animals? How do we treat our fellow humans? When it comes to seeing the earth and plants and animals as containing a part of the divine and taking action based on that belief, I have a few stories that come to mind. When I was serving a church in Somerville, just a few miles that way, there was a congregant and a faithful choir member named John, and he was very involved in the church. I'm sure you all know this type. Helping with new member gatherings and with coffee hour hospitality, John was welcoming of visitors and encouraging to the pastoral staff. And all of these things that John did were so, so wonderful, but it was not actually what he was most known for at the church. What he was most known for was his praying. Because each week during our time of joys and concerns, people would voice their prayers aloud in the sanctuary. And John would pray aloud the exact same prayer every week. He would say this, "I pray for sensible action on climate change." John would give voice to the need for creation care in the form of legislation and action regarding climate change. And in a way, what he did, speaking these words aloud, his weekly prayer, they held a vigil for the earth each week, right there in the midst of our service. John did not only pray each week in church, but he worked tirelessly to affect action in regards to climate change policies. But it was his prayer in church each week that really inspired everyone else. John was committed and passionate. John saw that the earth was a reflection of God's own self, of God's own handiwork. And he took that belief and turned it into action, including this weekly prayer in the company of his fellow folks at church. And now there are other ways that I see people doing what John did, taking that belief that God is present in nature and in creation and turning it into real action. Several friends of mine engaged in a Lenten plastic challenge this year. They saw that creation is worth caring for and have challenged themselves over the course of Lent to stop using plastic altogether. I was just out to lunch with one of them yesterday, and she had an extra reusable straw that she was carrying. And so when they said, "Do you want a straw?" she said, "I have an extra." And so I got a reusable straw there too. And so these folks are going around and they're taking their glass containers so that when they have leftovers, they can pack them up in the glass containers to take home. And they've really done all that they can to just ditch plastic. disposable straws in favor of metal ones, reusable ones, and more. These folks are committed to respecting the holiness of the earth by taking action to protect and care for it. All these little actions that add up. Speaking of plastic, several weeks ago I preached at a church in Exeter, New Hampshire, up the road that way, and when one of the members stood up during the announcement time, she came up with this huge bag of plastic bags, and she just started throwing them all over the front of the sanctuary. It was quite a performance art scene, and she was illustrating this devastating effects of plastic bags on our environment, bags that take years and years to decompose and that wreak havoc on nature till they do. But thanks to an initiative that's happening in churches and community organizations all across the country right now, these plastic bags, which so often damage God's earth, they're being repurposed into useful plarn, sleeping mats for unhoused people. That which was a threat to God's earth is being used instead to help God's people. So talk about redemption of the plastic bag, a real turnaround for an item that was so damaging turned into something so useful. And this reminds me of the Christian symbolism of the cross, an instrument of torture repurposed into an instrument of grace. Plastic bags repurposed into something that cares for people. Perhaps some of you will be inspired to turn your belief that the earth is holy and that people are holy too, and turn that into action. Collecting plastic bags and crafting these plarn sleeping mats is just one way that some folks are doing that. So if we believe that people are holy, that they too are made in God's image, and that they contain this spark of divinity, how then do we treat the people? How are we in relationship to them? I propose that such a belief ought to lead us to trying to see not just the good in one another, but truly the God, the divinity in one another. Such a belief might lead us to try to notice the ways in which God's immanent love shines in each of us a dwelling place for the Holy Spirit, which animates us. This past couple of weeks, I've been rereading a book called Blessed Are the Crazy by Reverend Dr. Sarah Lund, and I highly recommend this true story about what it's been like for the author to grow up in a family with significant mental illness in her father, brother, and cousin. In one part of the book, Lund tells the story of her cousin Matt, who found himself on death row. Her cousin was a survivor of absolutely extreme child abuse, both at the hands of his birth family and then later in his adoptive family as well, who were trying to control Matt's outbursts and energy in truly devastating ways. So Matt's violence with other people was met with even more violence at home. From this tumultuous upbringing, Matt grew into a very, very troubled young adult. One day, Matt responded to an advertisement for a horse for sale and went to a nearby property to see the horse. And while there, he committed a heinous crime that led to his arrest and imprisonment. Not long after, Matt was tried and received a death sentence. The author, Sarah, she had fallen out of touch with her cousin several years before the crime that led to his imprisonment. But after Matt had been serving time for a few years, Sarah reached out to him through a letter. She was in the process of completing seminary and had attended a lecture on the death penalty. This lecture inspired her to reach out to her cousin. And when she did, she received a response back from him that compelled her to continue to be in relationship with him. He wrote back to her to let her know that while in prison, he had become a Christian, that he had accepted God back into his life and was filled with this new sense of peace and purpose. He was remorseful for what he had done. And they continued to exchange letters with one another for several more years, all the way until the time of his execution arrived. On that day, Sarah sat with Matt in prayerful silence as he faced what was to come. And in her book, Sarah questions the death penalty her cousin faced, She said they would be executing someone that day, but it was a different person than the person who had committed the crime a decade earlier. Sarah said that as she sat in a small room with Matt before the execution was to occur, she saw the light of Christ within him. She saw that Matt was a beloved child of God. She saw that he contained a spark of divinity. So before the guards took him away, she told him, "I love you and God loves you." In her book, Sarah wrote that it felt as though in killing Matt, the state killed a part of God as well, as Matt was made in the image of God, even though he had done some truly terrible things. So if we truly believe that God dwells in God's creation and one another, I question, would we have the death penalty? Or would we act to change such policies in favors of ones that have room for grace, room for redemption, room for people to change, room for God's light to shine? Friends, as you go about your week meditating on today's scripture from the book of Job, may you seek to ask the animals and to speak to the earth about all the good that God has done in creation. May you find yourself meditating on the ways that you care for the earth presently and are called to further care for creation. And may you find yourself reflecting on the ways that you care for other people and are called to care even more. I leave you now with this blessing from poet John O'Donohue, who wrote the following poem called In Praise of the Earth. It goes like this: "Let us bless the imagination of the earth, that knew early the patience to harness the mind of time, waited for the seas to warm, ready to welcome the emergence of things dreaming of voyaging among the stillness of land. And how light knew to move the growth until the face of the earth brightened beneath a vision of color. When the ages of ice came and sealed the earth inside an endless coma of cold, the heart of the earth held hope, storing fragments of memory ready for the return of the sun. Let us thank the earth that offers ground for home and holds our feet firm to walk in spaces open to infinite galaxies. Let us salute the silence and certainty of mountains, their sublime stillness, their dream-filled hearts. The wonder of a garden, trusting the first warmth of spring until its black infinity of cells becomes charged with dream. Then the silent, slow nurture of the seed's self coaxing it to trust the act of death. The humility of the earth that transfigures all that has fallen of outlived growth. The kindness of the earth opening to receive our worn forms into the final stillness. Let us ask forgiveness of the earth for all our sins against her, for our violence and poisonings of her beauty. Let us remember within us the ancient clay holding the memory of seasons, the passion of the wind, the fluency of water, the warmth of fire, the quiver touch of the sun, the shadowed sureness of the moon, that we may awaken to live to the full the dream of the earth, who chose us to emerge and incarnate its hidden night in mind, spirit, and light. May you go into your week knowing that you, one another, and in fact all of creation were made by God, are loved by God, and contain the light of God. Amen.